I'm Sean. This is Chris. We wanted to talk about something that we've been playing around with, honestly, in the past year or so that we're kind of excited about. We like playing with different technologies and seeing how they can solve problems we have. And so we kind of got on containers and Docker, and we kind of wanted to share some of the experiments we've been running. We weren't sure what kind of level of familiarity with it. Like, frankly, a year ago, we knew nothing about these things either, and we're still not experts now. But this will largely be tailored to the level of familiarity within the room. So we kind of did a little poll before, but I'll do it again because there's new people. So containers and Docker in general, who would say you're like completely unfamiliar with them, you've maybe heard the word but have never used them before, put up your hand, please. Okay. Quite a few. Okay, so that's the majority. Anybody actually using containers in production? Okay, neither are we, so that's okay. And if you've maybe like kind of played with them, done some experimenting on the side, like you've at least run one Docker command of some kind. Okay, there's a couple people over there. Okay, so we're going to significantly tailor our presentation this morning to that, so please bear with us. So we'll spend a little bit more time talking about what containers are, what problem do they solve, why did we get so excited about them.
So is it fair to say many of you came here just because you were hearing about this Docker container thing and you're like, what's all the buzz about this?
Yeah, okay. Fair enough. That's basically how we got started.
That wasn't us very long ago. So hopefully one of the things we can demonstrate to you how easy it is to learn about this technology and become proficient with it.
And there's some great tutorials online and like pretty simple ones too, like the cost of entry is pretty low if you're going to invest some of your own time to learn this stuff. So I'd highly recommend go, like docker.com has some great tutorials. So we unfortunately won't show all of that, but I'd recommend after this take some time to go through those because they're pretty simple and pretty good, and it's a fairly shallow learning curve. It doesn't take too much to get the basics going. So I think I'd kind of like to talk about what problem are we trying to solve? Why did we get interested in this? One of the ones I know personally was I like to play and explore with different technologies, right? You're like, Django. I've never used Django before, but I'd kind of like to see what it's about. A new version, or Nginx, what's Nginx, you know, how can I use Nginx as a reverse proxy? Names, so there's all these different things out there, and lots of them. Jenkins has a new pipeline feature in their thing, I want to kind of play with that. And so you kind of have these like discardable experiments, right? Like I want to try some technology, learn a couple things about it, and then at the end of the day, maybe I don't like it and throw it away. So you want to be able to do that quickly, right? You want to be able to throw it away very easily at the end. And so this was a problem personally I always had was by the time it takes you to download something, you know, install it on your computer, configure a bunch of stuff, and then you decide you don't like it, and you try to install it, but it leaves a bunch of stuff hanging around, and it conflicts with stuff in the future, and now your hard drive is a mess. It was an impediment to learning, I found. So one of the big reasons I was interested in this is like, oh, it makes it really super easy to try new stuff. So I think that was the first problem. And I'll let Chris talk about kind of where he got into it.
If you didn't see the keynote, a lot of what he was talking about was separating the sort of what we do, what we're trying to build from what it runs on, right? We spend a lot of time sort of configuring systems and servers, and this keeps us from actually spending our time on the real like business value work that we do as developers. So I'm going to walk you through one of the examples of what got us interested in this. And this isn't a deploying, say, like a website into production or services into production, but this is more of a config management type problem. So for those not familiar with that, when we build code, usually we have source control and CI servers, so developers will check code in and we'll have a build server that will build the code, run all the tests, and then if you're using a continuous deployment pipeline, you would actually then ideally deploy that into production once everything's passed. So this is a sort of typical thing we've seen, this is like with Jenkins, you'll have some Jenkins master machine that's got all of the configuration of what's going to run. And then you've got these different build agents. And a lot of times, we'll be spending a lot of time configuring little nitty-gritty details on each of the machines, right? And I've heard them given little pet names, like they'll have these long, complex serial numbers, and somebody will just call it, that's the Z machine. You know, that's the one, that one just acts up all the time. We'll just reboot that one when it's not working. We'll have this other machine that we affectionately call the R machine, because it starts with the letter R. And, you know, this one, we put some little special packages on it. They're kind of annoying to configure. But you know what? There's this one project we barely ever build it, so we don't want to spend time configuring this on every one of our build agents. And then we've got this, you know, extra machine, and it's the one that's set up just right. It's perfect. It never fails, and it's in theory the template we use to create new build machines. So what happens is we spend a lot of time configuring these machines rather than figuring out how do we build our code efficiently and develop, spend more time actually developing software. This was a phrase come up by a guy at CERN. It's this concept of cattle, not pets. So pets are things that we, you know, we give them names. When they get sick, we nurture them back to health. We take care of them. We look at them fondly. Cattle are things with serial numbers. We can, you know, grow the number of cattle we have very quickly. And what we want to get to a point is where basically if our systems are getting sick or we want to add more systems, that it's not a lot of extra work or configuration. So Docker, I don't have a slide that describes this, but one of the benefits that Docker has that we found is it allows you to configure machines. And so this was a tool that this is one of the tools that we're going to talk about later in the presentation. Basically, it's a tool that allows you to decouple the configuration of your build pipeline and the way you build things from the systems and servers that run on them. So we want to spend basically no time configuring our build agents at all. We just like to be able to tear them down and spin them up at will. And Docker is one of the tools that allows us to do that.
Yeah, and environment parity in DevOps is a really big thing. As a programmer, you know, you always run that, well, it works on my machine. Doesn't, you know, and we kind of make fun of that, like, well, your machine, we'll ship your machine to the customer, that doesn't count. But works on my machine should mean something, and I wish I could quote who said that, but works on my machine should mean something. We should have environment parity. We should be confident about environment parity, that the environment that I'm working with is the environment that Chris is working with, is the environment that's on test, is the environment that's on prod, and the differences that do exist are very well-defined, well-documented, configuration managed between the environments. And I mean, Chris and I were recently working on a project where it's like, okay, well, we need to introduce like some really obscure old technologies. Like I think there was, I can't remember, there was some old stuff in there.
4NT?
Yeah, there's some.
I tried to Google documentation on it and I couldn't find any. That tells you how old.
Yeah, and there's some old Perl scripts and other things. Like, well, we don't want to have to make every developer go through like all, and getting Perl configured with an Oracle database and all this kind of stuff. It was a complicated set of things you had to do. And to then, and this is for kind of like a rather small project. And so then to have to try and get an entire development team to all go through the steps, you know, precisely and not like anybody makes a mistake and we get it all, it was a bit of a nightmare. So this is one of those instances where you do it once, see configuration management, now you can have all your development team use the same environment. Then you can...
Thinking of one example, we were playing around with an ETL technology called Talon, and what we're trying to do is figure out a way so we can run our ETL jobs inside of a container and deploy them into a swarm. And I'd spent a little bit of time, it was like a few days, to configure all these things and get them set up just right, and it was coordinated with like a GitLab server and a bunch of things. And then Sean, he had come back from vacation, I think it was. He's like, oh, I want to catch up to where you are. So he pulled the Docker compose file and the configuration he had onto his computer, and I think you were up and running in 2 minutes.
Yeah, and this was like a complex set of different servers and daemons. Like, there wasn't just one thing. It was like, this is one of those things where if you wanted to deploy this on like an actual production server, the old-fashioned way. I mean, we would have had to put an IT ticket and wait 2 weeks or 4 weeks, and it meant that we could have these reproducible environments very quickly. So these were some of the challenges and problems that interested us in kind of experimenting and learning more about this. So I'll give it maybe a brief introduction into what are containers, because as we've been talking, you might be thinking, well, they sound suspiciously like virtual machines.
That's not untrue.
It's not exactly untrue. Mitch, who is standing here a few minutes ago talking about the work he's done at HashiCorp, he was the original author of Vagrant. And there's a lot of parallels. In many ways, Vagrant does for virtual machines what Docker does for containers.
I don't think it's showing up, Sean.
Oh, OK.
You're right. I think they're still seeing our. Just kill the presentation. Yeah. Okay. Nope, still not. Gotta maximize it.
Gotta maximize it. So okay, let's try this.
So, if in many ways, he provides some virtual machines and containers provide similar things. In the sense that they give you reproducible environments. But what are some of the challenges we have with virtual machines is, one, the images are very big, because you actually have not only the kernel, but the entire operating system, the entire file system. There's a lot of other stuff that goes with it. So you rarely see a virtual machine image that's less than a few gigabytes. The other issue with virtual machines is they often take a long time to start up. You're starting up the entire kernel every single time, so the boot up time is often several minutes. The other constraint with virtual machines is that because they're running on the hypervisor, they have all the resources kind of pre-allocated to them. So you don't necessarily get an efficient use of resources because you have to allocate each one for their peaky load, the maximum amount of memory or CPU usage they're going to use. But if you've got a process running in one of those and we want to isolate all our processes, 90% of the time it might not be doing that much. And so you've kind of got this kind of inefficient resource utilization. What containers have done is they've essentially run off some kind of old kernel technologies, kind of they've packaged it together in a new way. So instead of virtualizing all the hardware through a hypervisor, they all run on the same kernel. So they share the kernel, but they have complete file systems. They have completely different file systems. They have completely different process spaces. They have completely different network stacks. And so as far as the application running in a container is concerned, it doesn't know about anything else. And so it can have its own dependencies, it can have its own software, and they don't interact.
So for a maybe less, so I know there's some non-technical people in the room. Big advantage, the images of these things are small, and they spin up quickly. That's a good summary?
Good summary.
So the analogy is, back in the day with shipping. You could find the shipping analogy there.
I will find that, yes.
Okay. So let's say 200 years ago, if you wanted to ship a good of some kind, maybe you've got some food, and then maybe you also have some, you've got some, oil containers, you've got a piano, and so all these different types of things you want to ship, and they've got different forms, right? They physically look different, or they've got different sizes, weight, shapes, and so you'd have to figure out, well, how do we stack all these things on a ship, or how do we stack all these things in a on a train? And so you had this problem of you've got different forms that the goods come in, and then you've got different forms of transportation, and so you've got this N by N problem of you have to figure out how do we get these different things all across these different different modes of transportation. And so the solution to that was the shipping container, which is all the goods go into this one standardized box. That's an international standard. And then we design our modes of transportation such that they can all take this standardized box. And so now your your truck, your train, your ship, your rail, all carry the, all they need to know is they need to carry the box. They don't care what's inside of it. On top of that, boxes don't interact. Without the box, you can't ship the monkeys next to the bananas. But when, if you've got monkeys in one box and bananas in another box, they don't interact. And so when you put them in a, when you ship them, it doesn't matter. So what does this mean for us in the software realm? Well, before where you had to worry about, like, okay, well, I've got, you know, I said the environment on my own machine, the environment on production, the environment on test, there's all these different environments. How do we be sure that we've got environment parity between them? And also, let's not have to worry about interactions when we don't need to. Let's not have to worry about dependency problems and conflicts for things that have no need to really care about each other. So going back to Chris's example with continuous integration, you've got a Jenkins machine, for example. Well, now you have to install your build tools. You have to install maybe some test frameworks and tools on there. Now you have to install maybe some performance testing. And maybe some, you know, UI, you know, some third-party libraries. Well, they might not necessarily need to know about each other. For example, your build tools don't need to know or care about your maybe your automation frameworks, your runtime automation frameworks. So why all kind of put them on the same thing and have to worry about conflicts and dependencies? Like let's try and separate things and have them very small and atomic as much as possible.
There it is. Oh, we can skip. We'll come back. Oh, you know what? I'll show you. I'll come back to all this. So, one of the interesting things about the way that Docker works is it's actually we don't just take an image and ship the whole image. So you can actually go up onto Docker Hub and like you can pull an Nginx image or an Apache web server image. What's actually doing is it stores the information in the container image in a, what's called a layered file system. So what this allows you to do is we can add new information. So you can take your base image and you can start adding on your application and HTML files and all these different things. So actually the additional things that you add are a very, very thin slice on top. So that's what you can see here is this is a base Ubuntu image. It's actually made up of multiple layers in the system. So this is all, what's the phrase, idempotent? So the image itself is part of the container. So there's a different sort of terminology thing here. A container is a different thing from a container image. So the container image is the read-only part of the file system that you can ship and share with different things. And once this tiny thin read-write layer is once you deploy the image, once you run the image, this is the ephemeral pieces of information that are changed while the thing's running. So do you remember in the keynote he talked about, I think it was three different types of state, ephemeral state, sticky state, and persistent state? So containers, a lot of time, are ephemeral state. They're state that you can launch, do some activity, and then tear it down. So you're not persisting the data. And if you go back to the original diagram here, when I'm running a build process, I pull my source code, I compile it, and then I deploy the compiled thing. While I'm compiling it, that process, there's no reason that that state needs to persist after I've finished my build process. So this is one of the real advantages of containers is I spin this thing up, the actual read-write portion of the container gets processed and then we throw it away. So, I think I had another, we've lost our, so. So like we have like lots and lots of different containers that are running. So that's a very challenging problem, and we'll talk a little bit about it. I don't know that we're going to go into that in detail,
But a lot of the stuff that Mitch was talking about this morning in terms of, I mean, like, running in a production environment, how do you manage them all? Like, that's what a lot of what
Kubernetes
and Kubernetes and schedulers do.
Cloud Foundry.
Yeah. We'll do a little bit of a demo with registries. So how do you actually have a central registry of what are all our containers, internally
so
with the company?
Two separate problems. One is the container images. We've got a whole bunch of different container images, so that would be something you'd store in a container registry. And the other one is then you're running containers themselves. You've deployed them into a swarm. You've got lots of different running ones. They have to do talk and communicate. That's the technologies like Kubernetes and Swarm and Cloud Foundry. The first one is easier. It's just it's more or less a source control problem. Storing your images, so they're just named and versioned. Okay, the connection between the build process. So, can you pull that back up?
Sorry.
I keep pointing to this. You guys aren't looking at that. I'm not used to this thing.
Was it this?
Pointing at the screen and no one knows what I'm... Okay, so we might have an image that describes how to build a piece of code. So it's got all the dependencies to build the code in it, right? When I actually build the code, I then launch a container. So I could have many different deployed containers doing the sort of... this is the ephemeral information, the stuff that we throw it out when we're done. So each one of these, say multiple people check in code, we may actually want to independently build each of those revisions. So we can actually show you that the build process will launch one container to build the first revision of the code, another container to build another one to build another one. So each one of these will have different versions of that code in them. And then when we're done, it can deploy individual versions of the output result.
I think we could probably get to let's start doing some examples.
I think if we get into some examples, it'll start making sense. Yes? You reuse the image, yes. So. I think this will make more sense once we show some actual examples. Whoever's talking, can you please? There's a lot of echo. Oh, are they behind? Yes, absolutely. So that's a very good. So the question was, we do have to persist data at some point. How do you do that? And we'll talk a little bit about that. You can mount. So the main solution is you can mount a volume, an external volume, into your container to allow you to persist data. But one of the big principles that we try and follow is to have your persistent data in one place. So you have your ephemeral processes. That you can scale out as a separate problem to solve, then where do you store and persist data? But there is a mechanism to do that.
So this is .com. So Docker is probably the prevalent container technology at the moment. And the nice thing is they've actually built the whole ecosystem around it. So we won't kind of go through getting set up and installed, but please go to the website and they make it super easy to go and for developers, and you can download on Windows, Linux, Mac, and they've got tutorials to get started. What I'm going to show you is hub.docker.com. And so we mentioned before about a container registry. Well, this is kind of the GitHub of the container world, which means that people like open source, if you create an image for something, you can publish it to Docker Hub. So there's all these publicly available images, and Docker actually maintains official images for lots of the really popular technologies. And so, for example here, I'm going to say Postgres. So if you want to find a Postgres image, there's actually an official Postgres image, and it will actually give you a lot of information on how to use it. So you can go down here and you know, read a lot of details about how to deploy the thing. But fundamentally, it's a pretty simple, you know, how to start an instance, Docker run.
So this is actually a perfect example that we ran into. So where when we're dealing with ETL stuff, so if you're, I don't know if any of you do ETL stuff, but a big challenge is repeatable environments between dev, test, and prod. And we were trying to solve this problem where, well, when I test something, I don't want to have to go and get an IT ticket and do some like complicated process to configure a new database server when really all I need to do is like run some small unit test on a piece of code. So really what I want to do is like spin up a database server very quickly and then tear it down. So this is actually an example of like an ephemeral database. It's not there for persistence, it's this just there for my tests. We used a Postgres Docker image for this. So you just run the Postgres.
Why don't we do it right now? So I just, they've got how to start a Postgres instance. I'll just copy this. So there's this Docker run command. I'll give it some name. I can refer to it later. No, we're going off script. So I'll just take this and I will paste this into my command prompt. And okay, so the first thing it's doing is it said it could not find the image locally because I have not used this image before on this computer. So it immediately goes to the public Docker hub to say, can I find this Postgres image? And then it says, okay, what are all the layers in this image, in this layered file system? And it begins to download them. Download them here.
See, a bunch of them say already exists. So this is this layered file system we're talking about. So a Postgres image is not a Postgres image. It's actually some additional layers that have Postgres sitting on top of some other, probably, I'm guessing Ubuntu like that, right? So what you're actually seeing here is they say it already exists because we already had that on our system, and now it's just downloading the incremental information that it needs to know to run Postgres.
And so there we go now.
We have a database running on it.
Yeah, now I have Postgres running, and I could just Docker PS, so PS to display the processes, and I can see that it doesn't format very well on the screen, but I have one container running, and it's off the image Postgres, and it's been running for 10 seconds. And
one of the problems we were trying to solve is we want to be able to spin up a database server with a specific schema, right? So it's not just we don't just want to when we're running our tests, be able to spin up a database server. We want to spin up a database server that has all of the DDL scripts already run on it. And then one of the things we can do is now we can create our own image that has an additional layer built on top of that that now has the DDL already configured. So now if somebody wants a database server that already is configured with these tables and stored procedures and all that, they can spin that up without any extra work. So they don't have to figure out how to like pull the creation scripts and set it up with all the right configuration. And we were doing this with Oracle, which had a lot of really annoying small little configurations we had to do. So one of the things we're going to show you is creating what's called a Docker file that describes the basically all of the commands that need to be run to configure a container image.
So the nice thing, if you go on Docker Hub and want to look and see how to get started, so you see at the very top here, you'll see for any image on Docker Hub. So we're looking at Postgres right now, but they'll actually have what the Docker files are, and these are configuration managed on GitHub. So what they'll do is you'll commit a new Docker file onto GitHub, and then it will trigger a build of a new image on Docker Hub. And so we can actually look at a Docker file here. To see what the Dockerfile for Postgres looks like. And
one of the principles that Mitch talked about was declarative, right? We want to tell the system what to build, not how to build it. So the Dockerfile is an example of telling what is the configuration of what's going on in here. We don't want to tell it all the nitty-gritty details under the hood of how to
Does
just DDL, yeah. But you could, if you, you could build that into, I mean, and this is where separating the actual data from a container is, you want to have a little bit of a separation too. And if we can talk about that after. I think for the sake of time, yeah, we're going to start actually jumping into
right,
showing some examples.
Right.
Yes, yeah, so you do need Docker. If you're on Windows, there's a thing called Docker Terminal. Windows 10, so if you're before Windows 10, it'll actually install a Linux VM onto your computer. And you need the Docker daemon running.
And how do you connect to the legacy applications, right? So if you have an application which is running on a regular Windows platform, it has a different OPC connection to your APIs. So all those configurations, is it always able to manage them directly, or do you have to do something else?
We've dealt with legacy systems, and what we've found is that we've been able to wrap an entire legacy system into a container. Then you could start breaking it apart and building it into smaller systems, but maybe that's a maybe a more complicated topic. I'm more than happy to talk to you after the presentation.
So just very briefly there, while we were talking, I stopped the Postgres server, and just to show you, once you've got all the images pulled, how quickly it is to start it up again. So I'll just go, I'll run the Docker run command again.
So there's a couple people that have slept out, so there's some extra chairs for those standing.
I really wish I could. We tried before and we couldn't.
Hard to read.
Yeah. We did try before we started, and we weren't having any luck. So the boot up time for an image is like on the order of seconds compared to like if you were to do a virtual machine. So I want to just show you quickly like other examples of other images you can get on here. So like if you're looking at, so go back to Docker Hub, and examples of different technologies if you want to play with them, how easy and quickly it is. So there's an Nginx if you want to look at Nginx as a hosting server. Again, it'll give you the how to use this image, Docker run, and it will give you a tutorial how to run it. If you want Python, and we ran into this one recently. Okay. Yeah, so I'm just showing some examples of different official images. So here's an image for Python, again, and how to get started. So you don't have to necessarily install Python on your local computer. You can just pull an image for Python. Another one would be, you've got an Apache server on here too. So pretty much name any kind of technology and it exists as an image somewhere. So now to try something, it's just a one-liner, more or less a one-line command to try a completely new technology.
So like Oracle is an example of this that we, so the question was about licensing. Oracle doesn't host their images on Docker Hub.
Well,
we're able to make our own, but now we have to deal with things like how many licenses of, I think there's actually, we looked through the Oracle licensing because we wanted to deploy a bunch of Oracle servers into a swarm. And then I think their licensing language was something around you can only have, for Oracle Express was like one thing running per computer.
Yeah.
So you do need to, it doesn't make it free, you do need to like still manage like how many of these things are running.
Oh, this is just Oracle Linux, sorry.
Let's move on to building a Docker file.
Okay, so first thing, so what we're going to do is we're going to actually, now we've spent some time giving a bit of a background, is go through a demonstration of building a very simple web application and deploying it in a container. So now you've got this nice box at the end, and then this moves all the way from your local development environment into your production environment. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to build this on top of Nginx. Just as you know, pick a web server. You could use Apache. We're going to use Nginx. So I'm actually going to go to Docker Hub and just look up what the Nginx repository is, or the images, and look and see how do I actually run this thing. And let's give this a shot. So go Docker run, and I want to expose a port. So the port 80, which is inside the container, I actually just want to expose it as port 80 on my machine. So you can do this port mapping. So I'm just going to say port 80 should be mapped to port 80. And now just I'm going to run it in daemon mode and nginx. Okay, so now if I just run to my IP, there we go. Okay, so now I've got a web server running, and that's that.
But a web server on its own is not useful, right? We want to actually have some of our own, so we're just going to do like a basic HTML file running on the web server to display example, but you could make it, obviously make it more complicated.
So we'll just make a very simple web page and say so the worst web page, well, it's not even HTML, but whatever, it'll work. So now we need to get this web page into the container, and what we want to do is really extend the image. So images kind of have, or containers kind of have this hierarchical inheritance-based system. So we can't just use Nginx anymore. We actually want to extend Nginx to include our own source.
Remember, it's this layered file system. So we're going to add our own layer to the existing container image.
So I'm going to create a new file, and the convention is to call it a Docker file. So I'm going to create a new file called Docker file. And there's this domain-specific language that they use, and you can go online to look at the reference. The first thing we need to specify is what image are we inheriting from? So it could be Ubuntu, it could be, so just like a starting point, which has nothing much in it except for Ubuntu, or you could go from something that already has things installed. So in this case, Nginx. And so we do that by saying from Nginx. So it'll pull that image and then it'll start, we can start adding things on top of it. Some of the things we can do is we can actually run commands. So if we need to install extra stuff, like maybe an Oracle driver, or we need to add
Python,
you can actually run. And now you can just have access to any of your Linux commands. So like run apt, get, install, you know, and you can install whatever things you need to install. In this case, all we need is the web server. So all the steps that would normally go into like setting up a server, you know, like it's really a pain to go through and have to type all these commands out all the time and then tell your friend to get them to do it in the same way. It's basically more or less a script for how to build this repeatably. So in this case, we don't actually need to install anything. What we're going to do is just copy our one HTML file that we've made into the file system on the container. So the declarative command for that is copy, and we'll say it was public HTML index.html, and we want to copy that into, right? There we go. So we're just going to copy this index HTML from my local file system, and when we build the container, it'll now take the Nginx base image, and now it will copy this file in, and now it's all packaged together. And so we'll do an example of that. We'll go Docker build, and I'll go dash T to give it a name so it's easier to refer to it. I'll call this agile-India source. And now I'll just specify, build it from the current directory. And you can see what's on the screen. We already had the Nginx image, so from Nginx, and then the next command was copy, so it copied my HTML file in. And I just want to make sure I don't have it still. Okay, so one interesting thing is if you don't specify the name of your running instances, it'll just pick something like this. So I don't want to stop Hungry Edison. It'll randomly pick one for you. Okay, so now let's build our run Docker run. Oops, Docker run map port 80 to port 80, and I want to run, what did I call it? Agile India source, and There we go. So now we'll go back to our web page, and there we go. So there's an example of how we've packaged our dependencies and our application together.
Oh, that doesn't look right. How do you get the slides back up?
We'll try that.
Okay, so
you don't want, obviously you don't want to like manually be building and deploying these things all the time, right? So one of the presentation we're here to talk about is actually doing this seamlessly inside of your continuous integration pipeline. So what we're going to show you is using this tool called Concourse that will build. So you know what? I'm going to use the mouse.
Okay. So we're going to check in our configuration of our system, the source code. We'll show that. We're going to pull it, build it, deploy it into a Docker registry that will store. So the image that he just built, we will actually store that inside of a registry. So in your I think one of the common ones is like Nexus. AWS has a container registry system. And then we will have a step that will actually deploy it into production. So this is probably the least secure or safe way of deploying software. We're not going to be running any tests. We're not going to be running any security checks. But what we're going to demonstrate for you is we're going to be able to go from changing the file, checking it in. It's automatically going to build it. It's automatically going to push the container image that gets built into a registry and then deployed into production, and it'll all happen seamlessly. And so when we're done,
the first thing Sean's already done is he's built this Nginx image and deployed it. We're going to have a, I think I lost where I was.
Let's go all the way back. So Sean, so we're going to build a GitLab repository. So this is actually some place that we can store our source code. We're going to show you how to persist that. So one of the questions was, these containers are ephemeral, so we want to actually persist our source code, our source control system, so we're going to have some mounted volumes. We're going to build Concourse. It's going to run inside of containers, so Concourse requires three separate containers to run. Web is the container that your web browser talks to. That's the shows you the cool UI interface. It persists stuff to a database, and then it has the workers, which the workers are the individual build agents that run and build the source code. This is a Docker registry that stores the images. We're going to have that running inside of a container. This is Swarm, so this is a one way of deploying services so that they can be discovered. And then the last thing, finally, is the thing Sean already built, which is the Nginx web server that has the very simple sort of Hello World example. And then eventually, ultimately, we'll be able to demonstrate a full continuous deployment pipeline that'll connect to you from your web browser. So we started here.
This is already done. Sean's already built this. He's already written the Docker file that describes it. Talked about this. Now he's going to, we need to persist our Docker images, our container images, the same way we persist source code. So now he's going to create a registry image. He's going to launch that, and we're going to push the container image he built into the registry.
Right.
Yeah, it's kind of like a source code repository, exactly. Yeah. So like the company we work for has like a central Nexus server, and it's got like namespaces and all sorts of different things, so people can push all sorts of images.
Right. So we showed you Docker Hub, which is the public one, but if you're building an application, you're not going to necessarily push your application to the public Docker image repository. So this is something that would be part of your own infrastructure internally. So what we're going to do is set up a large amount of infrastructure just for the purpose of the demo here to kind of demonstrate how easy it is to do. But reality, you'd have your own source control, you'd have your own repository, and these would just be things that you would run and maintain within your company and you wouldn't have to do every time. But we're going to set all of this up as just a demonstration of how easy it is to use Docker to spin up these things just so we can build a deployment pipeline for you.
So while Sean's running, getting the registry running, I want to talk about one example. I talked a bit about the example of creating the image that has your DDL on it. So what I've seen a lot of times is people What's the definitive source of what your database's structure is? A lot of times I've seen it's actually the database itself. So if somebody wants to make a change, they'll go make the change on the database server. I think that's a really, really, really terrible idea. Especially if we want to then do that in multiple places, right? So what I would do, would suggest doing, is having the DDL in source code. You could create a build step that builds a container image, pushes it to your container registry. So now you've got a container image that has, and you can make it versioned, because the DDL of your database is going to be versioned. So now you can have a container image that anyone can pull in your company that has the configuration of your database so that everyone doesn't have to go set up their own individual databases. All they have to do is go to the registry, have the name of that image, have the right version, pull it and run it, and then they're set up. You don't want them to look at the Docker file. You want them to actually pull the image itself. But one of the things we could do with Concourse is you could have the, so once you check the code in, once you check the new DDL in, you could have it auto build a new image and auto push it to the registry. My experience, it's not very mature. I give Microsoft a lot of credibility for sprinting to catch up with the curve on this. Concourse does work with Windows containers. I haven't played around with it. Sean, you've experimented with the Windows containers. Maybe do you want to comment? What is it?
One more thing I wanted to ask is, can you run the Windows containers on Linux machines?
No. So the question was, can you run a Windows containers on Linux and vice versa? The answer is no, because it's actually running on the kernel.
Yeah.
So Windows containers run on Windows, Linux containers run on Linux. However, Sean discovered when he installed Windows 10, because Windows containers only run on Windows 10. Yeah, they actually have a like Linux VM built into Windows 10 now. So this is the big advantage, is you configure once. Once you create the, so this is, complex configurations are a great use case for this. Because it might take a lot of work to get all of those individual packages and things set up into your image, but then it's there. And then you never have to do it again. Maybe I'm not answering your question.
Now, I'm just thinking, would this also screw up the UI render and doing
Yes, like you have to say yes to some things, right?
You say yes and then execute some job package and prove that the UI for customers. So what do you think about the UI and then we'll take over UI?
Most of those are being scripted now, we found. Like you can interact with them through the command line. Fewer and fewer pieces of software, Oracle included, absolutely require you to do it through the UI. There are ways to script them. Yeah.
I don't have a good answer for that.
I'd be very surprised how many pieces of software, especially in a server environment, absolutely require you to go through the UI to configure them.
Yeah.
To me, this is a little bit like Oracle's a great example of they're not embracing this technology.
Well, they're getting there, I think.
They're getting there. They're a little bit slower, so. They're starting to make it so you can do all that from the command line, like Sean said. We're just gonna move along with the demo. So you saw at the end we have this like really complex set of containers that we're running. So Sean's creating what's called a Docker compose file that allows you to spin up multiple containers and then have them talk to each other.
Yeah. So. Rarely do we just have like one thing we're deploying, right? Like the one web server. It has to connect to a database. It has to connect to another service that's running for authentication. So you end up with these stacks of different things that all need to be connected together a certain way. So you saw I was doing all the Docker run commands before with all these, you know, commands. Well, that gets kind of tedious after a while. So Chris and I really like using what's called Docker compose files, where you can actually compose a bunch of containers and declare how they run together as a stack. So in this case, what we're doing is basically building, if you were to start a software company today and you need, like, well, we need source control, well, we need a registry, we need all these things, what we're doing is really declaring the entire stack for one of those. So you can see we've got, this is a Docker compose file and it's a YAML format. So one service I want to run is a Docker registry, or my own internal Docker registry. And fortunately, there's an image for that. So I can just specify what I want to call the service. I can say what image I should pull from, what it should use, and then what ports I want to expose. GitLab, we need to have a place to put our source control. If you don't have one already, but in this demo we do. So I want to run a service called GitLab. This is the image I want to use, and I'm specifying a specific version number. I can specify some environment variables we want to pass in this case what the URL is going to be for it, exposing ports, and getting to the question earlier around persisting data, we want our source to control, or we want our source to kind of stick around, you know, if the server shuts down, it'd be bad if it was ephemeral. So in this case, we've actually defined externally mounted volumes that we've given names to so that these will stick around beyond the life cycle of just the container itself. And so, if everything goes according to plan, I can.
Is your container still running? Your Nginx one?
I think it's up to port 80. Good call.
Oh, yeah, kill it.
Oh. Stop. There we go. Okay, so the once I've defined my stack of different things I would like in a Docker compose file, I'm going rock Docker compose up. And I've apparently formatted something wrong.
This is the best part of doing a live code demo is when something does some typo. Okay, mob programming. See the typo.
Oh, this is it. Indenting.
Indenting, perfect. All right, so we just spun up a registry and a GitLab server. And the GitLab, so the obviously you don't want your source control server to be ephemeral, right? So we've mounted the persistence of the source control to a volume on his system. So
just taking a moment for the actual GitLab to get going.
Okay. So why don't you push your image that you built to the registry?
Oops, wrong button.
Got about 40 minutes left.
Okay.
No, we're about halfway through. Everyone stand up, get your blood moving. And if you're fine, I'm sure some of you in this room are finding this going like way more basic than maybe what you're expecting. I will not be offended if you leave. So can you guys close the door? I'm getting a lot of noise from outside. Just I can't hear the question. Maybe I'll come down to you. Okay. I'm not really that familiar with Cloud Foundry, but I suspect it is. And actually, the tooling we're using, Concourse, is built by the same people as Cloud Foundry. You can push the container images to the Cloud Foundry and then they get spun up into, so I suspect it is. Right. Yes, the volume is just on his laptop. I mean, you can mount the volumes externally. One of the things we were doing is we were using AWS and we had a container swarm, basically. And we mounted the volume rather than mounting it to like an individual VM. Like these containers have to run on a VM. But what you can do is you can have a sort of cluster of VMs that you can
use a like load balancer to figure out where to deploy the container to. You don't just want to mount the information, like you don't want to mount onto like this individual VM. I don't, once again, the VMs, it's same principle, cattle not pets. I just want to be able to throw out those VM instances that these containers are running on. So there's EFS, like Amazon has Elastic File System, so we can actually mount to like another external, it's like basically it's equivalent of like a network drive. For Jenkins?
I think so. I haven't tried that. That's a good question. Yeah, I think you can. That's.
The question was, can you use a container as a node for Jenkins?
Let's find out.
Is there an option?
There is an option for that? Okay.
I've got a question with security.
Security, yes. Okay, so, yes.
Second question is, what is the option of having your private health?
Okay, so the first question was around security. One of the security considerations is secrets. So you actually, I would say a absolute best practice is you don't want to store like server passwords and SSH keys like inside of your images. You want to separate, I think,
That's what
the keynote talked about.
Vault. That's essentially what Vault does, like what HashiCorp produces. One of their products is Vault, and it's secret management, and how do you get secrets into containers.
So there's a way to, when you launch the container, to inject secrets into the launch container, but you absolutely don't want your, you don't want someone to just be able to pull your image and automatically be able to connect to things in your system. It makes it, so that would be a security consideration. The other question was around, why do you want to have your own internal hub for the images? Part of that is, is all the things you're writing, do you want them to become publicly available?
Whatever it is, that it needs to be within internally with the Docker.
Yes.
So we don't want to actually do it on pushing across onto the public Docker.
Right, yeah. You might. I mean, lots of companies are moving like totally open source, so you might want to do that. But generally speaking, you don't.
But if you imagine actually it's a financial industry, right? That's
yes.
Actually a kind of a security concern.
Right.
Or to have something like a private cloud or a private hub kind of concern.
Exactly.
So is it an option available in the Docker?
Yeah, so there's quite a few technologies. Like AWS has a container registry. You can just spin up your own. So like there's a contain like one of the things we're doing is there's an actual register container that is a registry that you can spin up. Nexus is the other product we talked about. That's one of the ones that the company we work for. They use Nexus. So the interface to them is identical to Docker. Push and pull images just the same as you do with Docker Hub. So it's.
So Nexus is integrated with Docker and that is going to get the.
Yeah. Are there other technology, like registry technologies that you know of? There probably is.
Yeah, I think there's some more. Yeah. Yeah. So there's Docker's own, there's Nexus, there's the one you mentioned, AWS's registry.
Sure
the nice thing is that the API is standardized, so it's largely agnostic to which registry you use.
Sorry, speak up.
Kubernetes.
Okay, yeah, Kubernetes has one too. Yeah.
Okay. So while we've been talking, what I've done is I now have GitLab running inside a container, and now I've created a repository so we can actually put our source code somewhere. I also have a Docker container registry running on my local computer, so now we have a place to push the images to you. So if we go back to the diagram Chris had earlier, we have GitLab with persisting the data to volumes, and then we have the container registry running locally on the machine.
Forward, not back, because I think I'll incrementally build it in the image.
What I would like to show is what I was typing there, which was this Docker Compose file. The one thing I'll just point out is here's the GitLab server we're running now, and so here's the persistent volumes we've added to things. So Chris will kind of explain where we're at and then what the next steps are.
So we've
We have our web server image. We've got our registry that we've launched. We've got GitLab that we've spun up. We showed you this where we've mounted a volume within the container into a folder on our machine. And next, what we're going to do is we're actually going to spin up Concourse. So Concourse is this open source CI tool where everything in Concourse is built on containers. We're going to run it inside of a container. It runs all of its jobs inside of a container. Basically, it's built from these all these concepts that we've been talking about are first-class citizens inside of the Concourse technology. So one of the things we've seen is Jenkins machines, like we said, they tend to build up these like little individual configurations. Everything in Concourse is configured inside of a container image and run inside of a container. So there's no state that sits around inside of these machines. All of the configuration lives in your source code repository.
Right. So if you want to add more build agents in, you don't have to configure a build agent very much at all. All the configuration is held in what is called a pipeline file that defines for the specific code repository what are all the things you need. So if you add more developers, you want to make things faster, all you do is you just add more Concourse nodes and it scales. And it means that you can have per check-in builds, and you add more developers and it slows down, and you add more nodes and you still get per check-in builds, and they don't interact with each other because they're using containers.
So the three basic concepts, and everything's built extremely generically. So it's not built off of any specific source code technology. So the first one is these concepts. A task is a sort of basic operation that runs inside of your CI pipeline, and it itself is a script, basically a script that runs inside of a container. A resource is basically anything that has like versions you can check, that you can like pull a version or push a version. So the simplest one is your source code. You can check for versions in your source code repository. You can pull versions of your source code. You can push new versions. There was a question, I believe, is a Docker registry basically the same thing as a source code repository for images? It is exactly is. So our registry is another resource in this concept. So there's a whole bunch of them. This is not working.
Oh, right.
There's a whole bunch of them that are built in automatically, so Git being the most commonly used source code system. You can create a time resource that will basically, you can like pull versions of it, so you're like, oh, is there a new version of time? It's a way to trigger events. You can say like trigger an event every hour. S3 buckets, Cloud Foundry was one. Somebody asked a question about Cloud Foundry, so you can push versions of your image into Cloud Foundry and it will like deploy it into production. And the way that Concourse is built is you can actually configure and build your own resources. So a lot of people in our company use TFS, so we could, in theory, build a TFS resource that you could interact with and pull and check versions. Then the last one is jobs. So jobs are these types of actions that are triggered off of a resource change. So a new version of someone's checked in a new version of code into the source code repository, a job gets kicked off, and it's basically the assemblage of a bunch of tasks. So an example would be building your code or running your unit tests, building a container image, these types of things. So when we're done, we're going to have resources. So these are the two resources that we have in our system. We have the source code repository and the Docker repo, the Docker repo being the registry that contains the images, and these are the jobs. I thought that was funny. So the two jobs that we're going to run is take the Docker file, build a Docker image, push it to the Docker repository. The second job we're going to run, take the Docker image and deploy it into production. Okay, so Sean's going to actually set up the Concourse system. He's going to add it to the Docker Compose, and then we're going to spin up our Concourse system.
Right, so what we need is those three, the DB, the web, the worker, those containers that make Concourse. We need to deploy those three containers, and so we're going to add it to our Docker Compose file, and what I will do here is show you what I'm doing. I'm going to cheat somewhat
for the sake of time.
Which is, there's just some environment variables that need to be set up for Concourse to know.
Actually, if you scroll up, there's an example of a hard-coded secret. Scroll up.
Yeah.
Like username. Oh, there it is. Username and password. He's hard-coded into his compose file. That would not be a good practice. Generally speaking, you'd want to have your credentials somewhere else and then inject it into the container when it's run.
But for the sake of simplicity, we're going to bypass that. So it's actually going to be three separate Concourse containers. And this is just the way Concourse itself, the developers have built it all containerized itself. So they've created essentially like three, it's like microservices, right? You've got three Concourse services that interact with each other. You've got the web server that our web browser, so when we see that CI pipeline, that beautiful CI pipeline, that's all running on the web server. You've got a database that persists certain things, and then you've got the workers. Individual workers are their own individual containers, and those are the ones that you can scale out. So you can spin up n worker containers.
So that's kind of that like microservice architecture where you keep things small. When it becomes easier and easier to deploy things in their own containers instead of having one thing that does everything.
And they just connect like network communication.
So one of the things in the Docker Compose file is he's told the containers how to talk to each other. So there's essentially like a little bridge network that all these containers run in and a little DNS server that runs in. So you can like name the individual containers and then tell them how to talk to the other containers.
So Concourse is now running, and this is the page you get when you first see Concourse, and says no pipelines configured. So we do need to kind of tell Concourse what the pipelines are, and there's a command line tool that you can download to do that. So I'm just going to download it in the directory I want, and then we will go through and we will create our first pipeline.
So the pipelines, the build pipelines themselves are code as well, right? We want to have everything configured in code and checked into our source code repository. So when you pull a version of your repository, of your source code, it doesn't just have all the source code, it has the information now, because it's got the Docker file that will describe the thing that's going to run. You can have Docker files that describe the thing that will build your source code, and you can have a pipeline file that describes how to orchestrate it all. So has anyone ever been in a situation where you had to fix a bug on something that was built like 4 years ago, and you go find the source code thing, but you pull it and you try and build it, then you find out that like the environment has changed, like the development environment has all changed and it's different, and now I have to go hunt down like what versions of different things were installed on people's machines. The ideal is if when you pull a version of your source tree, everything in that source code describes everything that is needed to reproduce the build that you originally had. And this includes the configuration of the build servers as well.
So what I'm doing now is I've used this, you can see here, I've used this fly CLI tool to actually interface with the Concourse server. So the first thing I did was I just logged into it and I declared a target. So now I called it light, but I can refer to this Concourse server as light from now on. So the next thing I want to do is actually define what our pipeline looks like. So that image Chris showed you before of how information flows from GitHub, or sort of our GitLab into, and then build it and now deploy it. We want to define what that looks like in a declarative form. So Concourse uses a YAML format, and we want to create one of these pipeline YAML files. And so first thing we want to do is declare our jobs. So
remember, the jobs are things that respond to changes in resources and can push changes to resources. So the resource we're going to respond to is the changes to our source control, and it's going to build our Docker image and then push to the Docker registry. And Sean does not know this off memory. He's got a cheat sheet, which is okay. So trigger this, this trigger flag, what that's telling you is when a new version appears in the source resource, it will automatically kick off the build. So this is optional. You don't have to do it. You can have jobs where you can go into the web interface and manually kick the jobs off. Now I think we've been kind of being a little bit hard on Jenkins. They've been moving this direction as well, so they've been getting to the point where you can totally have their pipelines configured as well in code. So this is a lot of what he was talking about in the keynote this morning, is getting towards declarative systems. We want to say what we want the infrastructure to look like. We don't want to spend time like actually setting it up ourselves.
Okay, so in this pipeline file that I somewhat cheated on to in interest of time, so here's the jobs. First thing we're going to do is just one job, which is build our Docker image from our source and then push it to our repository. And so that's what this does. And now we have resources. Our resources, one, is our source in GitLab and how to access that, which branch to be on. And then
we've got some secrets there, so we don't want our pipe. So we don't want to check in the username and password of our GitLab server into our source code repository, right? We want to have those all somewhere else in our vault.
And then the next one, the second resource is the actual Docker repository we're going to push to. So now that I've created this pipeline file, we can go back and use our command line interface. Actually, the one thing I need to do, I do need the credential file, so I'm just going to copy over the one that we had created before that has a username and password on it. And now, so now I'll run our fly and we'll target our light concourse database and we'll set pipeline and call it main pipeline. And
so this next step is he is going to, so he's injecting this last part that says load bars from. This is the command that allows us to inject secrets into our concourse pipeline. There you go. For the sake of time, have you checked the code into the repository yet?
I don't believe I have yet.
Okay, let's do that. There's nothing to build yet, so.
It was agile source. Okay, git add.
I don't see your Docker file there, though.
Yes, sir. Oops.
So just going to do our first check-in of the configuration of our Docker file that will then build the image. All right. So
and if all goes according to plan.
If all goes according to plan, we should see this start build. Have you pressed play yet?
No.
For the sake of time, why don't we just kick the build off? Just so.
Okay.
All right, so we're building. So now it's building. So remember when he went Docker build originally and it pulled the Nginx image and then it built the image with our index.html? It's now doing that for it. So you can see it's pulling from Docker Hub. It's downloaded it, and it's going to build that image for us. And of course, we're over conference Wi-Fi, so this is going to be incredibly fast.
Yeah, so this might take a few minutes because the Wi-Fi is slower. But the one neat thing about this is you do get like pretty much out of the box per developer builds, because if you get a check-in, because everything runs in containers, they don't interact with each other, so you can create n number of containers for each of your builds. So every developer.
You have like seven developers all check in at the same time.
They each get their own builds for each of those check-ins.
Right. Michelle was talking about, like, you know, your monkeys and your bananas. You don't want them next to each other. They're like self-contained things, right? So each build is being built inside of a self-contained container, and they can all run next to each other and not interfere.
So I don't think we're going to get time constraints. Yeah, well, I think we've got enough questions. That I don't think we'll get to pushing to production, and PowerPoint just crashed. But if I go back to here, the next.
People have been sitting for a while.
So. Yeah, I think we'll. There you go. So the next step from here would be, okay, now we've pushed the image to the Docker repository. Now we want to deploy it to production. So we would add a new task for the deployment step. And in this case for the demo, what we're going to do is we have a Docker cluster running on the computer. And so now we would just run this update command and say, update to version 2.0. And then it would pull the image, and then suddenly you've got the new version. And you can do things with all these schedulers and with the different schedules out there. Is you can set up different deployment options, so like a rolling deploy, so it doesn't tear down everything and have all services not working. It'll actually deploy kind of the new version bit by bit, and actually have some waiting period to make sure that you can check to make sure that things are operating properly before it tears everything down. So
talking to the mic so it gets recorded.
So you get kind of like no downtime, zero downtime deployments. Now clearly you wouldn't want every check-in to go straight to deployment. So what kind of things may you want to add to your pipeline in between? Tests, right? Yeah. Right. And so I think Jez Humble did a talk on this. I don't think he talked about the last year. He talked about building these pipelines where you want to have various stages of testing go throughout. And the purpose of the test is to prove to yourself that you can't deploy it. And if anything goes wrong along the way, then that pipeline would fail, and that would be your safety check. Yeah, so check marks there. I mean, one thing they do is, yeah, secure. So you could actually build your security checks into and have that as a separate step in this pipeline here.
Like one of these gateways that would prevent you from deploying.
Yes. That was kind of, I think we'll leave a couple minutes for questions. People have been sitting for a long time. We didn't get to going all the way to production, but frankly, that's kind of a bit of a trivial step. You just create a new job, you say, this is the one command I want you to run to push it into production, and you're pretty much done at that point. The one interesting thing is I'm going to pull up Concourse.
There's some really good tutorials. I can't remember the people that made them, but I found them on GitHub. They have like a step-by-step guide to using Concourse, and it builds. You can follow along and build your own pipeline and build your own tasks, deploy them onto your machine. And like you've seen, it's very easy to just run all of this stuff internally within your own machine. You don't have to like actually get servers requisitioned and everything. So you can play around and get to know these technologies on your own.
They do have a Slack channel with people who are like very, very helpful. And this is an open source thing, but Pivotal maintains it. And so there's a lot of great people who help out with it. So here is actually the real active production pipeline for Concourse itself. So Concourse is actually used to run its own production pipeline. So you can see kind of the complexity with which you can build some of these things. Yeah, so we deployed a lot of stuff this morning. What's that?
Yeah. If there's any questions, now is the time. We've got about 10 minutes. I'm just going to make sure, yeah, people ask a question, please use the microphone. Just so everyone.
Compared to Concourse with Jenkins, like what are the more advantages apart from the Docker? Because like Jenkins provides like
Yeah, so that's a good, so actually Concourse has a good, the question was Concourse versus Jenkins. And Jenkins is adding a whole lot in terms of pipelines and containers. So I think the whole, this is more of a demonstration of where like the whole CI community is headed to. You're gonna see more convergence from Jenkins and all these other ones to support declarative configuration managed pipelines, support tasks in containers. That's where we're headed. Concourse, I think, is leading the way in that regard. Concourse does have a good page I've put up here that actually explains Concourse versus Jenkins, Concourse versus Team City. Why did they bother creating Concourse in the first place? And one of the things, like you mentioned, why Concourse exists is with Jenkins, you've got all these plugins. But with each plugin you install, that's also a bunch of configure. You have to install the plugin. You have to configure the plugin. And if you want to add another agent to your cluster, now you have to go and find your list of agents or your plugins and install them on that and on that as well. So Concourse's philosophy behind it is don't do any of that stuff, and the trade-offs you get are it's kind of infinitely scalable.
It is less mature of a product, right? And one of the things I talked about was like the different resources. So like that would be an example of like plugins, right? These different resources. It supports Git out of the box, but it doesn't support TFS. No, and no one out there has written one for TFS. So you know, the first person that does it, I would really hope that they open source that and push it up to GitHub or to Docker Hub and GitHub, right? So I personally hope that this takes off and that we see more of a community around it, and the more people that start building these things on their own, we can start leveraging these things. But this has a lot of potential to do the kinds of things you're talking about that are already built into Jenkins. It's not there yet. Any other questions?
We want to compare the performance from grid to grid. So how this Docker and container ecosystem support this compared to the performance?
The performance.
Because in order to compare the performance, you need to have the same hardware, same thing, except the code remains changed.
So the performance of the build or the performance of the execution? The execution of your actual application, right? Concourse doesn't really have anything to do with the execution of your application because it's building it, but then once you deploy it. So there's a lot of good monitoring tools out there, like container-based monitoring tools. It's kind of like an exploding industry at the moment. I couldn't tell you any off the top of my head, but the idea is, okay, you deploy it to production, and now you've got you instrument your application somehow and collect those. But you can have 1,000, you can have 1,000 containers potentially all running exactly the same image in peak load. And so you need to monitor all of those things potentially. And then if traffic, the load is low, it auto scales down to, you know, a handful of identical containers. So the whole space around monitoring it's growing really fast. It's an important one for sure. I don't know if I answered your, we can talk afterwards if you want to, yeah.
I don't think we're not, we don't pretend to be experts about that. We pretend to be experts about all sorts of other things.
Is there an easy way to find out the difference between two Docker images or the delta?
Yeah, the easy way is they've got SHA-256 hashes, so like you.
What's in them though?
Oh, what's?
I would not look at the image. I would look at the Docker file, right? And so you're not usually manually deploying a Docker image. What you do is you go and edit the Docker file. And then that gets built and then built into the image. So a lot of the Docker Hub images you'll see are backed by GitHub repositories, and you can go and look at the actual Docker file that was used to build that image, and they'll be versioned together. So you can, if you have a specific version, if you have two versions of a Docker image on Docker Hub, you can go back and then dip the Docker files that were used to build those Docker images. That would be my recommendation. Right. It's just a code dip because it's just a text file that tells you how to build that Docker image.
In any room or exactly software is there in the product image.
Right.
And it's seen that the script only needs to
be. Right. So like diffing two Docker images would like kind of be comparable to diffing two like executables. You wouldn't really do that. You'd look at the source code.
In case if I did not maintain the Docker file in any source control tool.
How do you maintain the Docker file?
In case if I haven't maintained.
So this is kind of come back to what is your single source of truth, right? We're talking about the database example. Is the single source of truth the actual database itself or the scripts that generate the database? To me, you want to have your single source of truth is code. Everything is code. The server is ephemeral. You can regenerate it from the code. So I would really, really strongly recommend not doing what you're describing.
So is it... can we maintain both the Docker file and the Docker image in Nexus together?
Nexus isn't really a source code.
This afterwards, we kind of maybe need a diagram to explain some of that. So,
in a high level, it's the same microservice thing. It's the separation of concerns, right? So you're going to have a source code repository and an image repository, and then you're going to have like something like Concourse that's going to pull from one, build, and then push to the other.
Of the session, you started with the number of build agents of the Jenkins. So, what if I just have one image machine and I'll have multiple Docker images within that machine that will be running parallelly? So,
yep.
That will be my entry having a lot of build.
Lots of build, yep.
Yeah. So, and if I want to define the dependency, obviously that will not be possible. I'm just creating all the builds separately and I'm just running them within one machine itself.
Yep.
So I'm just thinking that if I want to change this type of the way right now my build server is running, and this way if I want to change, will Docker be able to help me out in that case then? Say for if there are Java builds that are running in the same machine, AWS builds are also running, and maybe I can need to ensure that the machine should be decent enough to handle all those builds.
Yes, that's a good, so I think, if I understand the question correctly, it's I have one machine that's running all my builds, and so and all these things are running in parallel, and I need to make sure my machine is powerful enough to run all those things, right? So this is one of the concepts. Are you familiar with kind of the concept of scale out rather than scale up? So the sort of historical mainframe approach to doing this would be you would just make like some honking huge machine, and I think that actually Dave Thomas might have been advocating for this earlier in the week, is spend $50,000 and give it like a huge amount of resources. The other approach is because all these things can run independently and they don't interact, and because setting up a new machine, so this is one of the big advantages of Concourse, is setting up a new machine is trivial. I can, and then there's tools in things like AWS that can auto-scale it depending on how much is being done. Rather than having one huge machine, let's just add machines as I need them and tear them down as I need them. So those are the two approaches.
Agents would also be an exercise for us actually. And so because of that, if I can just have one machine and then, that's a difficult.
Yeah, and it's a trade-off, right? It's a trade-off. And having to deal with like, many build agents and scaling, it adds complexity to the system. I acknowledge that, right? So that's definite trade-off. And like I said, one of our keynotes earlier in the week was saying that hardware is getting better and better and better and getting cheaper and cheaper. And he made some quote about having like a terabyte of non-volatile memory within the next 2 years, which I would love to talk to him to get a reference on that. Maybe some of these problems that Concourse is trying to solve might go away. That's possible.
I think one of the use cases is if you've got, let's say, 150 developers all working on a product, and you want to give them like every commit, they get the feedback on did their own individual commit work or not. I mean, that's in Agile is a lot. Whole much DevOps and Agile, everything's about fast feedback loops, right? Like get minutes down to seconds, seconds down to microseconds, get the feedback faster. If I can be told within a second that my personal thing that I did broke something and it's preventing it going all the way to production, that's like makes things much more efficient and much more effective. So if we can provide the infrastructure that easily, cheaply, that enables to do that, it's a good cost, it's a good investment. So if I've got 150 developers during the day, I can easily spin up lots of nodes on Amazon that do that, and then like all bunch of build agents, like 150 build agents, everybody gets their own, and then at the end of the day, tear all of them down because everybody's gone home for the day, and or auto scale them to the amount of work that you need. But because they're all identical, all the agents are identical, they don't require configuration, it's very easy to elastically scale.
Like one smell is, do you actually log into your build machine? Do you like remote into it and do things to it? That's a smell. Because that indicates that the configuration of that machine, what's the single source of truth? As soon as you start doing manual configurations to a machine itself, it becomes a pet. It ceases to be cattle, right? So having, this is usually something that happens when you have one really large machine that you're configuring. People end up doing like a lot of individual, like, because this thing's gonna exist for like years probably, right? That one machine, so this is kind of a change in a mindset away from, we're gonna have this one machine that exists for years and I'll just like incrementally make changes to it, to the single source of truth about configuration lives in code and the machine itself is ephemeral. Does that make sense?
Yeah. All right.
We're out of time. We'll be around. So come up and ask us questions, and I want to be respectful of people's time. I think that there's actually like maybe 20-minute talks and stuff starting, so if people want to go, I will let you guys go. Thank you for hearing us ramble for an hour and a half.
Thanks.